So this is how he gets to that point. We are now on chapter. We are on paragraph 7. I'll notice just since we're looking at the outline now. What I tried to do in the outline, first of all, to abstract it from any individual pagination of editions, all of the numbers that follow are paragraph numbers. So it should be universally applicable. And in the right-hand column, I have cross-references. So for those of you who are interested in seeing all the very deep and numerous linkages between the content of the Gems of Divine Mysteries and both the Kitabi Egon and the Seven Valleys, I also have paragraph numbers in the Kitabi Egon. And unfortunately, page numbers in the Seven Valleys because it hasn't been paragraphed formally yet. So if you're interested in pursuing, and you can see that this column is just filled with cross-references. You find it, you know, almost point by point, the things that Baha'u'llah says, the points that he makes, or the main points of given paragraphs, are more often than not also found somewhere either in the Egon or in the Seven Valleys. So Baha'u'llah begins by asking this question, why have the prophets been rejected? And he gives the specific example of the failure of the Christians and Jews to recognize subsequent revelations. This is in paragraph 6. And he points out that they have followed the abject and foolish among their divines. Mm-hmm. A point he makes more briefly here, but which he expands upon in much greater depth and force in the Kitabi Egon. Really pointing the finger and saying a great share of responsibility for the rejection of the divines in every day and age are those possessors of religious authority, the clergy, the divines. Then Baha'u'llah in paragraph 7 discusses the elusive signs in the religious scriptures, which have always acted as a barrier to the understanding of them. He refers in particular in paragraph 8 to this passage in the Gospel, immediately after the oppression of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven. The powers of the heaven shall be shaken. This phrase appears, I believe, in all four of the Gospels in the New Testament. And this is also what takes up the larger part of part one of the Kitabi Egon, Baha'u'llah's exegesis of this paragraph. So he quotes from this, and then he quotes from a few other Gospel of Mark and Luke and John about the coming of the Comforter, about the other signs, and many of which were familiar, particularly paragraph 11. Baha'is, I think, are particularly familiar with these passages because they're often connected to, they're often used as proof of the Baha'i faith, you know, that there are indications in the writings and sayings of Jesus that someone else would come. But when the Comforter has come, for example, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me, and ye also shall bear witness, and so forth. So he quotes these various prophetic statements, and he says, no one has been able to fathom their meaning, paragraph 13. No one's been able to understand them. Verily their meaning hath bewildered the minds of men. And he says the position that they should be interpreted literally cannot be accepted, paragraph 14. And he says in paragraph 15, and the argument that they've been fabricated or just completely corrupted also cannot be accepted. So what is to be done? You know, obvious answer is, well, you've got to read these in a different way. And this is where paragraph 17 begins, with Baha'u'llah giving sort of keys to understanding of Scripture. He says, first of all, you have to understand them properly. He says, and I think that Baha'u'llah here is being a little bit, I think this is a case where Baha'u'llah is not saying the whole truth of things. He's telling someone what they can understand at this point. He's not able at this point to say, I understand these scriptures because I have my own divine mandate. Not only that, but I'm the revealer of a new religious dispensation. He can't say any of that at this point. What he can say is, to understand these texts, you need to ask those who really know what they mean. You need to refer to the possessors of knowledge. not sure how to read this, but I suspect that Baha'u'llah is in a subtle way referring to himself, because he ultimately does possess that knowledge, but he's just not able to say it explicitly.
Wasn't time to
say it yet. So he says, first of all, there are those who understand these, and the ones who understand them are always the ones who come after. You know, Baha'u'llah's one of the central messages of Baha'u'llah's revelation is that revelation is progressive, and that it comes periodically through a chain of divine revelators who are all connected in a way to those that came before, who fulfill prophecies of those that came before, and interpret for us and explain for us things that people before had said. And so in that light, Baha'u'llah is one of those possessors of knowledge able to understand and explain these abstruse matters. But having not said it explicitly, he just asks in paragraph 20, well, who can explain these mysteries? Well, only one who has entered the city of knowledge. Then he goes on and discusses the next point about literal interpretation. So having sort of eliminated the possibility, A, that these scriptures are simply corrupted, and B, that you can just read them as given, in other words, the poetry as prose, it's in paragraph 21 that he attacks this idea of literal interpretation, the error of literal interpretation, basically states in not necessarily in so many words, but that you can't understand these things literally. He says it he actually does say this in the middle of paragraph 23. Were thou to interpret these words according to their outward meaning, thou couldst never prove the truth of the cause of him who came after Jesus, nor silence the opponents, nor prevail over the contending disbelievers. For the Christian divines use this verse to prove that the gospel shall never be abrogated, and that even if all the signs recorded in their books were fulfilled and the promised one appeared, he would have no recourse but to rule the people according to the ordinances of the gospel. So this is precisely, I think, why Baha'u'llah is bringing out these quotations from the Bible, because he's showing that to get to Muhammad, you have to understand these Bible passages in a non-literal way. Then he, in paragraph 25, from 25 to 27, sort of brings it up to date, brings it into the present day with the rejection of the Bab's revelation. And of course, that rejection implicitly being because of people's literal reading of the Quran and the Hadith. Then he, in paragraph 26, readdresses this question of perversion or corruption of the sacred text and says, look, this shouldn't be an argument here. This should not be, this is not a good way out of the problem, just to sort of try to dismiss the previous religious scriptures. You have to accept them, but you have to realize that they need to be understood and read in the proper way. Then in paragraph 29, he moves into the third key. If the first keys are asking those who have the knowledge, not interpreting things literally, the third key being spiritual prerequisite of purity of heart. It's in paragraph 29 that we start getting into the spiritual prerequisites of the understanding of texts. Cleansing one's heart. Know thou that whoso seeketh to scale the summits of the divine mysteries must needs strive to the utmost of his power and capacity for his faith, that the pathway of guidance may be made clear unto him. And should he encounter one who layeth claim to a cause from God, and who holdeth from his Lord a testimony beyond the power of men to produce, he must needs follow him in all that he pleases to proclaim, command, and ordain. Even were he to decree the sea to be land, or pronounce earth to be heaven, or that the former lieth above the latter or below it, or to ordain any change or transformation, for he verily is aware of the celestial mysteries, the unseen subtleties, and the ordinances of God. So he says, if you encounter a true claimant to the cause, he says, then you have to follow what they say. He says, even if they declare land to be sea. On the face of it, this is a very, very challenging statement. particularly in light of what we were saying earlier about the core of Baha'u'llah's message being that you have to be free to reject religious authority. You have to have that spiritual freedom. And that spiritual freedom has to be passed on from generation to generation. This is a new way of being religious in the world. Then Baha'u'llah turns around and says, well, if and when you discover a source of spiritual knowledge, he says, then you follow them absolutely. And at that point, they can say whatever and you have to follow it. How is this not going back on the point he just made? Paragraph 30. So after all of this focus on this, on openness to the spiritual quest, while you're seeking, does the door to questioning, does the door to seeking slam shut the moment you have found the object of your search? Are you no longer in a seeking mode? Another way to ask it is the state of spiritual search a temporary state that we transcend or that we move beyond once we've attained the truth? Are we no longer seeking once we've attained the truth? How do we understand the statement of Baha'u'llah otherwise? Any thoughts on that?
The first thing that comes to mind to me is that if we're assuming that the scriptures are the truth,
yeah,
and he was just proposing that that statement, throwing the baby with the bathwater, that you don't just throw the whole scripture out if you don't understand it,
yeah,
or you just dive into it regardless,
yeah,
that you continue to seek through it and read it a different way to find what is the true message. And so I would then contend that you find, you know, the manifestation is stating truths that you're having difficulty following, then instead of just buying hook, line, and sinker, that you continue to investigate, well, what does he mean by that? Where are we going with this?
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think.
I think there is no, absolutely no way of reaching the truth.
Yeah.
The moment you think I reached that point, that's my ego.
Mm-hmm.
And as you said, it's the four seasons. It's coming and going.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be bringing you back to the state of a seeker.
Mm-hmm.
You are a seeker all the time.
There's a statement Baha'u'llah makes later on where he says, if having traversed all these spiritual journeys and attained all of these stations, he says, if there enters into the seeker's heart the least trace of pride and vainglory, I've got the answer. So at that moment, he will be returned to the first station of the search without realizing it.